One person has asked about the role of women in the Arab Spring. Another has asked about the Muslim Brotherhood and Islamists and the potential for them to take over some governments. If any of you would like to address the idea of what you think might be an unforeseen circumstance or an unforeseen outcome of the Arab Spring that may or may not be pleasant, maybe some people haven't thought about. I mean, I know Dr. Milani talked about the Iranian revolution, and women, of course, generally speaking, were very supportive of the revolution once it happened. They were less supportive once they understood the kind of circumstances that they would be put under. Is there something happening perhaps now in this Arab Spring, ongoing Arab movements, that you can see that's equivalent to that or something that's worth considering?
I think the question of woman, for example, as you raised, is very much an important question. In some of these countries, the demise of the despot has meant the loss of rights for women. Iraq is an example. The Islamists in Iraq are not willing to abide by equality between men and women in the Constitution. It's as simple as that. They say it is against Sharia and they're not going to abide by it. The Constitution called for equality during the despotic regimes of Saddam Hussein. Now they can't get this past the Constitution. They have sort of left this for future discussion. The other thing that I can easily imagine, and I hope I'm wrong, that could happen in Egypt is that the Muslim Brotherhood is in fact playing the card that Khomeini was playing. They are playing nice now. They claim they have undergone an ideological transformation. They do not want to enforce Sharia. They're going to abide by the laws of the land. And once they come to power, once they consolidate, they will move in that direction. That could be very much a bad news for Egyptian women and for Egyptian democracy and for the region.
Maher, yes.
Yeah, the whole thing started by a policewoman slapping Bouazizi on the face in Tunisia. So it was a policewoman who slapped him. Okay, so that triggered the whole of what's happened afterwards. The issue with the role of women in there, I think there's only one example, which is more than enough to show what's happened in the region. When I was in Jordan in April, there was a demonstration which I was watching on Al Jazeera in Jordan. The demonstration was taking place in Yemen against President Saleh. And the next day, the same day, he made this outrageous comment, is that women should not be demonstrating with men. So what do you expect happened the next day? There was a huge, massive demonstration with women in there, refusing or disagreeing with him on what he said and demanding basically his removal. So things have moved on forward. With respect to the Brotherhood, again, the Brotherhood is complicated because it has different roles in different countries. In Egypt, you know what? What's really exciting is that we're discussing in Egypt people jockeying for position, you know, the Muslim Brotherhood, the secular movements in there. People in Syria and Libya would cut off their arms to be in that position at the moment. Okay, they would love to be in that position. So just think of that huge leap forward that Egypt has undertaken. Okay, they're not worried about it. They're talking about the date. They're arguing about the date for the elections. Just imagine this happening in Libya or Syria. That'd be a wonderful thing to happen. So the Muslim Brotherhood may be playing a role in there, but if you look back at the days of Nasser, okay, at the days of Nasser, to eliminate the role of the Muslim Brotherhood, there were some agreements between Nasser and the party, the biggest party at the time, which is called Al-Wafd Party. Okay? Sorry, I'm mistaken this. Going back. To eliminate the role of the Wafd Party, the Muslim Brotherhood were talking to Nasser to postpone whatever reforms they were talking about. Now, it's the seculars who are talking to the current government to try and postpone the elections. Things have changed a bit. Okay? They're scared about the Muslim Brotherhood. But, you know, that's a fantastic thing. Okay? At least they're discussing a transition to democracy. It doesn't matter, okay, who wins or who loses, But at least we've moved a step forward. There is no going back on that. So the Muslim Brotherhood, I think they're not scary. Okay, don't be scared of them. We're not worried about them. I think there are other movements people can be scared about, but not the Muslim Brotherhood.
Let's go to Janet, and then we'll go to Nour. Janet.
Yes, but I have also just recently read that a lot of the young women who were instrumental in the demonstrations in Egypt have been excluded from the discussions on where we go from here. So we're not there yet by any stretch of the imagination. It's a long, long way to go.
Yes, Nour.
So two things. The first, to go to the Muslim Brotherhood, like I think he ended, is when you truly do your homework, and I think mostly people on the ground are the ones who only really truly know, is that the Muslim Brotherhood don't pose a genuine threat. Why? Is because the Muslim Brotherhood don't have a loyal support. How they always get their support is because the government has ostracized 85% of the population living below the 70% living below the poverty line, 69% illiterate. They have ostracized most of the population. Who has been there, right there to fall on when the government's been turning their back to them is the Muslim Brotherhood. And how have they been doing it? Through charitable solutions, hospitals, mosques, schools, centers, clinics, all of that. So that's how. So the moment, once they have a better option, the people will drop the Muslim Brotherhood like a hot potato. So I just want to let people know that too, to not be too worried, it's not a genuine support. And now second thing, in terms of feminism, we are in the supposed third wave feminism right now that we're in, and the solution, if I may, and please, absolutely no offense, but like you said, 29.7, that was the ceiling age of people on the ground, the demographics there. So in Egypt and most of these countries, please, no offense whatsoever, but the panelists right here would not be consisting, sorry, it would be people under 29.7 years of age. I'm being completely honest, I apologize. But that is it. People don't want to look to the older generation so much. And I think now where we want to guarantee women more rights in every sense of the word is it's going to start from the youth again. Because who are the women in the square? It's, again, nobody over 27 years of age. So it's going to come within the people. And again, say here in the States, how can you start teaching just more rights or in just developing countries? It's got to start from a human thing in the family. Of course, economic policies, political and social, but Islam and stuff, you have the Islamic edict as well as you go by the new constitution that we're forming right now as well as the old, the 1976, all of those, you do have women's rights in there. It's just we need the right lawyers to defend those. So all the stipulations are there. It just needs to be embedded in people's minds from a young age. So I think it's going to start off with the youth and hopefully with the years to come. But some say I'm an optimist, so we'll see.